Man, it's a good day. I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord. Last night I had an interesting experience. I was driving down the street here in Canyon, and I hope this person isn't here at church today, but maybe you should be. But anyway, I was driving down the streets of Canyon, and for some reason, when I get in my car, normally I have it on the auto. How many of y'all do the auto light thing? So your lights just control themselves, but I just don't ever mess with it. And so Janae's been driving my car this week, and I don't know if she turned it or something like that. I'm not going to blame it on her, but probably it's her fault. But anyway, it was turned. So when I left the church last night after our worship experience, my lights were off. But for some reason, I don't know if it was just so well lit in Canyon. You know, God just blesses Canyon. It just lit well all the time here. I don't know. I was driving away, but I never felt like my lights were off. I guess I didn't need them. I just have that good of eyesight or something. So I'm driving down the road, and then all of a sudden, this guy behind me, I was going to the grocery store to get something before I went home, and the kids were coming over to eat. So this guy's blinking his lights, just crazy, blinking his lights. And I'm thinking to myself, oh my goodness, what is going on? So then I thought, well, it's probably the kids, and they want something from the grocery store, so they're stopping us to tell us, because I'd ask them if they wanted something. So I slowed down, and he comes around me, and I'm thinking, it's our kids. And he comes around, and he gets beside me, and as he gets beside me, he rolls his window down. I roll my window down, and it's kind of an older gentleman in a really nice vehicle, and he yells at me from the top of his lungs, "Turn your lights on, dumb bleep." Let me just tell you, y'all better be glad I'm as saved as I am. That's all I'm saying, because some thoughts went through my mind, and they involved the police. I'm just telling you. I literally thought, man, I'm going to follow him. I retorted, and I asked for forgiveness later. I didn't cuss him out, but I was like, who are you talking to, man? And so I thought, man, I'm going to go follow him and have a talk with him. And then I saw pictures of Carlos having to come, and I was going to have to explain to him what was going on there. So sometimes people are just crazy. How many of y'all say amen? I'm like, what, brother, what is the matter with you? What's going on in your life that you have to be so vehement about somebody not having their lights on? So there's only two things I could come to the conclusion. Either one, this brother was blitzed. He was drunk, because no one in their right mind would do that. And he just ought to be glad that I'm as saved as I am. Come on, because there was a day, y'all. There was a day. And then two, either that or he thought I was somebody he knew. Because when I think back on it, I look at his face. As I looked out my window at him, he kind of went like that. And so I feel like he thought I was somebody he knew and didn't realize I wasn't. How many have ever done that before? This is not a good thing to do, because you'll say things you shouldn't say. Come on, somebody. I remember one time I was coming out of our church. We were at church in Oklahoma City, at Church of Harvest. And my daughter had just gotten a brand new haircut. She was about 14 years of old, Taylor, of age. And so she's standing in her circle of friends. And I walk out, and I just stand beside them, because I just like to stand in their circle and just listen to them talk. And so I just walked up behind her, and I put my hands on her shoulders. I'm just rubbing her shoulders, and I'm hugging on her. And I'm just, you know, patting her down, you know, just doing what daddies do with their daughters. And all of a sudden, she turned and looked up at me, and it wasn't Taylor. It was another girl that just looked just like her from behind. I'm like, oh, hello, how you doing? And, you know, that's not good when the pastor is, you know, patting up the young 14-year-olds in church. That's not good. Relationships are funny. Relationships are interesting, and relationships are important. God made us for relationship. God made us for interaction with other human beings. Sad to say, we live in a world right now where that seems like a very complex thing. It really is sad to me. I think about it a lot. I don't know if you think about it a lot, but just because of all the stuff that goes on in the world today, I think about it a lot. I think about how hard it is to just have relationship nowadays because of just such an opinionated culture and such a, you know, a polarizing thought processes and things. And I just think to myself, sometimes I think, man, why can't we just be nicer to each other? And oh, don't get twisted. It's on every side of every issue. Let's not act like, well, they're like that. People who don't agree with us, they're like that, but we're never like that. Come on, somebody. That's just not true. we have to get back to that place where we understand how important relationship is to us and how the dynamic of relationship is supposed to work. You know, this is why Jesus taught us to love, and he taught us to forgive, and he taught us to react right, which we don't always do, but he taught us to do that. He taught us to, you know, this is why Jesus said what he did about if someone slaps you on one side of the face, you should turn the other cheek. And I know in our culture, we've always said, I've always heard men say, I'm letting nobody walk on me. I'll turn my cheek once, but then you got it coming. That's not what Jesus meant by that. He meant what he said. It's so funny how we think that Jesus didn't really mean what he said. He didn't mean that for us. He meant that because he's Jesus, he can do that. He's got that kind of strength. But we don't got that kind of strength because we're not Jesus. Well, why would he have said it if he didn't want us to live that? Well, I'm not going to be a doormat for anybody. Nobody's saying be a doormat. But you know, the Bible even tells us in Proverbs in the Old Testament, it says that a soft answer turns away wrath. You know, whenever someone's mad and angry and we get right there in there with them and we get mad and angry too, what does that do? That stirs things up. How many spouses can attest to that? That doesn't put the fire out. That causes the fire to grow. Are y'all with me this morning? Somebody say amen, just so I know you're in the congregation. We can, and you know, we are really good in relationships about knowing what button to push. How many of y'all are good button pushers? You know what button to push. Come on, you can just bink. I mean, in a marriage relationship, as long as we've been married almost 30 years, how long have we been married? Is it almost 30? This was 29, this last 28? It'll be 29. Okay, I'm speeding this up a little bit. We've been together for 30 years, though, because we started dating 2 years before we got married. So 30 years, I'm telling you, I know every button she's got. And I am not, listen to me, I'm not beyond pushing them once in a while. Come on, you know you've been there, spouses, when you get in a talk and a discussion, you know we call it discussions. Interesting, intense discussions. It means you're fighting, y'all. And you know what you can do. You know how you can shut a conversation down, don't you? You know how you can do it. Just push that one button. Just push that. Say that thing. And then boom, the conversation's over. Or it goes into orbit. Somebody say amen. And that's a whole another level of fighting, y'all. I mean, you know why you're circling the earth in your anger. I'm telling you, it can be relationships can be complicated. Relationships can be hard, and sometimes we don't avail ourselves to them simply because it is complicated. And I know people who've been hurt in life, and as a result of the hurt and pain that they've gone through, they just shut down. I'm not going to have a relationship. I'm not going to connect with people. I'm not going to be vulnerable. I'm not going to walk this out. I'm not going to do it because it's just too complicated and it's just too hard. But can I tell you something? God made you for relationship. God created us with a need for relationship. And relationship is a tremendous blessing to our lives. We are created for it. Good relationship is good for the soul. It's good for us mentally. It's good for us emotionally. It's good for us physically and psychologically. And even spiritually, relational interaction is very important. There was a group called Social Wellness that did a study and a research. And they said this: there is a direct correlation between the degree to which a person feels connected to others and their physical and mental health. And they researched and they studied people as it pertains to feeling connected or disconnected. And here's what they came up with. The most commonly known effects of not feeling connected are, now listen to this, this will surprise you, some of these. I was shocked at some of these. Number one, generally decreased feeling of vitality. Less energy and feeling tired more often. This just simply means when you feel connected to other people, it gives you energy because energy breeds energy. There's a greater likelihood of chronic illness such as heart disease, cancer, or diabetes. Think about that. I don't know what the reason for that would be, but there is absolutely data that supports that when you are isolated and feel disconnected, it's not good for you physically. More frequent bouts of sickness, such as colds or flu, longer recovery times, regular feelings of loneliness, increased likelihood of depression, decreased happiness and satisfaction with life in general, and shorter lifespans. People who feel disconnected from other people live less or not as long as other people that feel connected. God created us for relationship. He created us to connect with other people. He created us not to just be around other people, but to connect with other people. When God created man, he literally said, he created this, he created that, he created this. He said, this is good, this is good, this is good, this is good. Then he came to man being alone, and he said, this is not good, of his own creation. He realized that Adam could not function or thrive in a disconnected atmosphere or a disconnected thinking. Well, wasn't Adam connected with God? Yes, but Adam needed to be connected with someone who was more on his level, more like him. And so God, you know what happened? He created Eve out of Adam. But I believe when God said this, he wasn't just saying it about this reproductive process or this process of marriage, although that is when marriage was instituted, and he took Adam and Eve and he put them together. That was when marriage was instituted, and it became the foundation and bedrock of our society. And that's why marriage is so important, ladies and gentlemen, because it is the foundation. Family is the foundation for society. So God put that together, but I don't believe for a minute that that's all he was talking about. I believe he was talking about it is not good for man to be disconnected from man, for man to be disconnected from relationship. Relationship is very important. So the point is, we were created for relationship. The concept of relationship is a part of the makeup of humanity, not just for reproductive purposes, but for true fulfillment in life. This is why Summit groups are so important. When we tell you, you need to get in a Summit group, I'm not just saying that as your pastor because it's a program we do and because we think that you need to be a part of that program because you're part of the church and that gives us good numbers and so we know that everybody's doing. No, it's not about that at all. We created small groups because of this right here. We created small groups because we know it's vitally important to come to church and to worship together in a larger setting, but it is absolutely imperative that we connect in smaller settings so that we can get vulnerable, so that we can build relationships, so that we can have people in our corner that help us and encourage us and keep us accountable and move us forward. It's very important. If you're not in a small group, I'm just going to tell you this. You're missing out. You're missing out on the opportunity for that spiritual connection through relationship. So I want to encourage you and challenge you and inspire you and tell you and command you as your pastor, get in a small group. You say, well, I don't know if I want to be in a small group and I've got all this stuff going on. But remember, it's not only Wednesday nights anymore. You can be in any day. You can lead a small group. You can be in a small group that meets on Sunday or Monday or Saturday or Wednesday or Thursday or whatever the day may be. Come on. We think it's important because you were made for a relationship. And let me just tell you, you weren't just made for a relationship, but you're made for the right relationships. Sometimes we wonder why our lives are being affected the way they are. And I'm just going to tell you, and you just need to take a step back, and then you ask yourself, who's around me? Every leader will tell you that you show me your set of friends, I'll show you your future. That's the truth. Who is got the most influence in your life? And if the friends around you, I'm not saying don't reach out for friends who aren't saved or reach out for people who don't know Jesus or reach out for people who need help. Oh, yes, you need to reach out, but that can't be your covenant corner. You know what I'm saying? That can't be the relationships that you count on that are always there for you because, listen, they don't know what you know. They don't belong to what you belong to, and you need to understand God wants to use other people in your life spiritually to make a huge difference in your life, and you don't avail yourself to that, you are missing out. Even Jesus himself did this. Listen to me. Jesus himself did this. Jesus had lots of people who followed him, 5,000, 10,000, 15,000 at times that would just be following him and listening to him speak. But then Jesus broke that down and there were 500 that were truly committed that left him when he started talking about eat my body, drink my blood. They were like, okay, that's too deep for me, I'm out. But there were still about 120 left that were following him. He even asked the disciples that day, the 12 apostles, he said, aren't you going to leave too? And they said, no, who are we going to go to that has the words of eternal life? You're it. But even in the context of that 12, Jesus had three that he hung around with most consistently, Peter, James, and John. Every time Jesus went somewhere, where did he go? Transfiguration. It was a special moment. Everybody else couldn't be there, just Jesus and three other guys. When Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, the most difficult moment of his life, who'd he take? Peter, James, and John. And then there was one called the Beloved in his circle. Now, does God love anybody more than he loves anybody else? No. But there are people who love God more than other people do. And John was one of those people. And John loved Jesus so much, and he understood Jesus' love for him so much, he called himself the Beloved. In other words, when John wrote the Gospel of John, frequently in the Gospel of John, he refers to himself as the disciple who Jesus loved. As if to say, he loves me more than he loves you. That's how it felt. He literally experienced that love of Jesus, and they were so close, that relationship was so tight, that they truly were like brothers. If you look at the time of the Last Supper, Jesus was talking, and the Bible says, and I always wondered what this meant, but the Bible says John was laying on him. John was leaned over onto his shoulder. And I was like, I've always looked at that and read that and thought, that's a little weird. Until I went to the third world, till I went to Africa one time, and a young man got in this conversation with me, and we were having dinner after a big crusade that we did, and we were having dinner, and he's one of the Christians. He was telling me all about the destiny in his life and the purpose of his life, and he wanted me to pray for him. And before I knew it, we were in this conversation, and we were talking to several people, and he was leaning on my shoulder. You can walk down the street in other cultures and they'll hold hands, same sex, they'll hold hands. It's not a sexual thing at all. It's a friendship thing. And in that Eastern culture of the Jews, that was not uncommon for them to be that intimately connected. And what I'm saying to you is, now I'm not saying that here at Summit Church. We're going to start that, gentlemen. Like, I'm going to hold your hand as we walk down the street. That ain't happening. I'm not for that. I'm just saying, you need to understand, listen to me, that there is a place of vulnerability and a place of intimacy in relationship that goes deep in our hearts, that causes us to be able to survive, causes us to be able to thrive, causes us to be able to move forward, causes us to be able to edify and edify others. Listen, it is an impact on your life that you are missing if you're not involved in it. So I'm just encouraging you, come on, take that step where you'll get vulnerable with someone. Take that step and do what you were created for. Have relationship, and don't just have relationship, but have the right relationship. It's amazing to me when people get hurt or when they go through something hard, they go through something difficult. It's amazing to me how literally they pull away from the important people. Have you noticed that? You're having trouble in your marriage. Do you ever notice that you surround yourself with people who also have problems in their marriage? Can I just tell you something right now? Do not talk to people about your marriage who have problems in their own. Like, if their marriage is falling apart and they're constantly telling you how they hate their spouse, get away from that person as immediately, as fast as possible, especially if you're having strains or stresses in you. Why do we do that? Why do we look for advice from people who, it's amazing to me, people will get advice from people who are horrible with money. Like, they're in debt up over their head. But because they look like they have money, somebody else that wants to have more money or is having struggle in their own finances will go talk to that person without finding out anything and just give me some advice. Hey, just get a credit card. That'll do it for you. Come on, why do we listen to people? And why do we surround ourselves with people? And why do we put ourselves in that context of relationship with people who are not going to move us forward? Don't you tell your kids not to hang out with the wrong crowd. Ooh. You might want to tell yourself that. Well, no, my crowd is good. Really? Are they good, really? Are they benefiting your life? Is your life moving forward? Or is it stale and stagnant? Are you doing things that you wouldn't normally do? You find yourself compromising in areas that you wouldn't normally compromise? Come on, somebody. You get quiet in this charismatic church this morning. No human-to-human connection, however, can fully satisfy or fulfill our need for connection. No human-to-human connection or interaction can fully satisfy our need for connection. It helps. It benefits. God made it to work. But it cannot fulfill or satisfy. This is why so many marriages have problems, because we set this expectation bar so high. And honestly, let's just be honest, we're trying to get our spouse to do what only God can do. Fulfill us, satisfy us, make us happy. No other human being can do anything of that sort for you. Oh, that's why I married my spouse. That's what I'm looking for in a man. Somebody who can make me happy. I don't know if that's, is that the West Texas woman's voice? Someone just make me happy. Really? Because I got news for you. About day two, you're going to realize this man ain't going to make me happy. I was fooling myself. I thought all this time I was going to be happy with this man. But this man has not made me happy. And it's only 48 hours in. Come on. Expectations on our wives that they're going to somehow give us satisfaction in life, that we're going to be okay and we're going to be complete now, we're going to be whole. Jerry Maguire, you complete me. Brother, you were broke and you're still broke. Come on, somebody. Two halves don't make a whole in marriage. Come on, if you're still a half, come on, get it worked out and go marry somebody else who's a whole. Not a hoe, but a hole. Come on, somebody. Come on. I'm sorry. I don't know where this is going. Oh, Jesus. I said hole. Y'all chill out. My wife's pointing at me down here. It's true. Anyway, move on. You can't be completed by someone else. A good marriage, a good relationship is two complete people coming together to do something significant with their life and live for purpose. It's not, if I'm broke in my life and I find somebody else who's broke, maybe we can work it out together. No, another broke person with another broke person doesn't work out and make a whole person. It doesn't. Half and half in this situation don't make a whole. Whole and a whole make a whole. Come on, somebody. But in all of the things that we do, listen to me very carefully. In our relationships, we cannot look for satisfaction, total contentment in that relationship, because human-to-human interactions and encounters will not give you the satisfaction you're looking for, because there's only one person who can do that. His name is Jesus. Our soul longs to connect with our Creator. He made us with a need to seek Him out. Every single person, the Bible says in Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verse 11 in the Amplified Bible, it says this: He made everything beautiful and appropriate in its time. And He has planted eternity, and what that means is a sense of divine purpose in the human heart. A mysterious longing which nothing under the sun can satisfy except God Himself. Yet man cannot find out, comprehend, or grasp what God has done, His overall plan from the beginning to the end. Listen to me, we need to understand that seeking that's on the inside of us that every human being has, that need for divine purpose, that reason we look in the mirror and say, what am I here for? Why do I exist? You can run from that all you want to. We can try to fill it up with all kinds of different things we want to. We can act as if that's not really an issue in our life. And many people just to satisfy and to fulfill and to ignore that there is that thing on the inside of them that wants that connection. They just run as fast as they can, be as busy as fast as they can, get it out of their mind, get it out of sight, out of mind, so I don't have to think about it. But deep inside, on the deep inside of every human person, there is a deep need, a deep seeking, a deep desire for connection with God. Because when God created you, He put it in you so that you would seek Him out to find Him. And that's what seeking God is all about. The sad part is many humans are not looking at all the signs and the symbols that we see around us in the very creation, that there is a God and I need Him in my life. And they're starting to try to fill it with their own intellect, fill it with their own arrogance, fill it with their own desires, so on and so forth, and it never fulfills. This is why addiction never satisfies. This is why substances never make you feel better, or it never gets better, or it never becomes content. Never. Because you just get some and it makes it go away for a minute, and then you have to have some more, and then it numbs you, and then it has to be more, and then it has to be more, and pretty soon it has control over you. You don't have control over it, and it doesn't work. Because what you're trying to fill, that void that you're trying to fill with that substance or with that relationship or with that person or with those people or with that money or with those things or with that stuff, all of that is never, ever, ever, ever going to satisfy you. Ever. Because what you're trying to fill was a hole in you made by God that fits only Him. Does that make sense to everybody? So where the good life begins is in our relationship with God. The good life begins in our relationship with Him, and it enhances all other relationships that we have. The good life is that life that I don't have to live with shame. I don't have to live with guilt all the time. I don't have to live with overwhelming sin in my life. I don't have to live with constant struggles and problems, because the good life is not the absence of problems or issues. The good life is peace in the midst of the problems and the issues. And when we get to that place in our relationship with God that He is our fulfillment, He is our satisfaction, He is our answer, He is our resource, He is our solution, then what happens is all of those other things may be going on all around us, but they do not affect us or push us off course, simply because our trust is in Him. The good life is a trust life. That's what it is. So we have to develop and grow in our relationship with God. And many times we think, I'm going to get saved. I give my life to Jesus. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to go through the rituals. I'm going to do the things. And that's what the good life is. No, the good life is an ongoing, continual growth and development in the relationship you have with Christ. There's so much more than just being saved. Now, I'm glad you're saved. That's a good thing to be. How many of y'all would rather go to heaven? Come on. Heaven's a good place to go. Somebody say amen. It still does exist, even though we want to try to deny it in our society and in the world today. Hell still does exist. We may want to act like it's not there, but it's not. And I don't want to go there. Somebody say amen. Let's not talk about that. Why? We better start talking about it. We have been quiet about it for so long, the generation under us is beginning to question if it's true. Come on, we got to get back in the Word of God. Come on, I'm just going to stop. Pause for station identification. We got to get back here. We got to get back in here. We got to make this important to us. We got to make this important to our kids. We got to make this important because this is where the good life is. Let me just tell you, as somebody who has lived outside the good life, it's not good. It appears to be good, but it's a bait and switch. I've pursued things in my life thinking, oh, this is going to be the answer. This is going to make me happy. This is going to make me feel better. This is going to put me in the right crowd, blah, blah, blah. And what ends up happening is it looks pretty. It's like a bass fisherman. You know, those poor bass. There's nothing funner than catching a bass. Come on, somebody. Come on. Those poor bass, you throw some shiny looking piece of food. That's what they think it is. It's just a shiny looking piece of food that just gets out there. And it's just the sun is glimmering off of it and it's moving across the water. And you are the bass and you're thinking, oh, that is going to be so tasty. And you lunge at that thing and you grab a hold of it. And you're like, oh, this is going to be great dinner for me. And you grab it and ouch. And all of a sudden, your lip gets jerked halfway out of your mouth. If it's me fishing anyway, fish on, baby. That's how I'm like, fish on. I've ripped so many. I've caught lips before. Come on, somebody, anyway. That's cruel. I shouldn't say that. But it is true. But that bass thinks it's just going to get some food. But what ends up is pain and death. And let me, I couldn't give you a better illustration of the fake good life that the world offers you. Oh, it looks good. And you can get everybody in the world to tell you, hey, it's all right. It's good. No problem. But the truth is, when it comes down to it, you're going to feel the pain. This is why Moses said, I would rather endure identifying with my people than enjoy the pleasures of sin, because they're only for a season. Oh, there's pleasure in it. Don't let me make you think there's not. That's why it's so alluring. That's why we call it a lure. Anyway, let's move on. Listen, the good life is that relationship with God that causes us to be like Him, because you are who you are around. How many of you have ever noticed that? You associate with certain people, you start acting like them. My daughter, Taylor, oh, she's so funny. I love her. She just went out with her baby. And when she was 15, she was hanging around a girl that literally said the word like more than she said any other word. Like, you had to decipher and interpret what she meant between all the likes You know what I mean? Like she was like saying, like, you know, like I went down like to the store, like, and like I got me some pop, like, and I, oh, soda for y'all. I like, oh, it's Coke here. Y'all know there are other brands. Anyway, like this, like that, like this, like that, like this, like that, like. I literally taught a class to a bunch of college students on leadership. You got to be serious to be taken serious. And if you come into my office saying, like, I am not going to take you seriously. And so Taylor came home. Now, if you say that a lot in your language, I'm sorry. No offense to you. Like, I really didn't mean that. But anyway, I've got to finish. I don't know what I'm doing today. So anyway, she'd come home, and that's what she was talking like that. She would never, ever, see, like, the way I just use that word, like talking like that, that's the appropriate use for that word. Okay, so anyway, she'd come home and she was saying that word. I was like, who are you? You're hanging around so-and-so. I knew exactly who it was. You're hanging around. Because we begin to take on the characteristics of those who we are most consistently around. And it works the same way spiritually. We don't grow spiritually because we're keeping the rules. We grow spiritually because we're hanging out with Jesus. That's why. You grow spiritually, you start acting like him, you start living like him, you start thinking like him, that's why the Bible says put on the mind of Christ. It doesn't say follow the rules of Christ. It says put on the mind of Christ. When you start thinking like Christ, you'll start acting like Christ. You'll start speaking like Christ. Come on, somebody. And how do I do that? I do that by spending time with Christ. Well, who is Christ? Christ is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, who came and gave his life for us. He came in person, in the flesh. He is the second person of the Trinity. He is God. He has always been God. He'll always be God. And how do I spend time with him? Well, I pray. I seek his face. I talk to him. I converse with him. And I get in his word. Well, why getting in the word? Isn't that just following the rules? Isn't that just trying to learn a belief system and follow? No. Because this book is not like some history book or some lecture book or some textbook. This is a life-giving book, because these are the words of Jesus himself and all those he represents. And the Bible says in the beginning, in John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was God, and the word was with God, and all things made were made by him, and nothing was made that was made without him. He is the light and the life of men, and the light shone in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And it goes on to say that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us as we beheld him as the only begotten of the Father. Every time you open this book, you're spending time with Jesus. Every time. Every time you truly pray and sincerely seek his face, you're spending time with Jesus. And what happens as a result of that, you begin to take on the characteristics of Jesus. Like Galatians chapter 5 verse 22 says, it says, but what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our life. And he's talking here about the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, temperance, faith. These things come out of our lives, not because we're adding them to our lives. I'm going to do more faith today. I'm going to love more today. I'm going to be patient more today. I'm going to care more today. I'm going to really work hard at it. No, you can work hard at it all day long. It's not going to happen for you, because your old man, your old nature, your flesh is going to come booming out and fight against that. How do I cause that fruit to be born in my life? Then spend time with Jesus. The good life of submitting my life to him, making his relationship with me the most important thing in my life. When we have relationship with Jesus, we begin to manifest the characteristics of Christ. And that, in all of its maturity and all of its glory, that's the good life. That's the life of peace. That's the life of joy. That's the life of contentment. That's the life of happiness. You want to be happy, learn how to be content. You want to be content, learn how to rest in Jesus. So here's what Jesus said. How do we develop this relationship with him? In that passage of scripture that we just read earlier, here's what he said. Here's how to develop a relationship with me. The first thing is, come to me. He said this. Are you tired? Are you weary? Are you burned out on religion? Come to me. In other words, he was saying, the things that you're trying in the world are just making you tired. They're not helping you. Are you weary? Have you been trying really hard to work really hard and be really good? Are you weary? Are you burned out on religion? This idea that some kind of ritual, this idea that some kind of list of rules, this idea that some kind of thing written on a page is going to make you better as you try to own it, as you try to do it. That, are you burned out with that? And how religion condemns you, and how religion accuses you, and how religion says to you, you're no good and you're never going to be good. Are you burned out? He says, this is what you do about it. Come to me. Now, when he says come to me, this is the beginnings of developing a relationship with him. And I've got to close. So as I'm just starting my notes, I'm going to close. No, I'm joking. Really, there's only like 5 pages left. So come to me. Here's the implication. He's saying don't go to someone else. Don't go to something else. Come to me. He's saying life, all the things that you have tried to satisfy have only resulted in you being more tired. He said, it's time to leave those pursuits and focus on me. The second thing he said is, get away with me. Get away with me. Some of y'all right now are so tired, those words just sound so good. Just the words, get away. I mean, come on, somebody. How many of you have ever been in that place? I just want to get away, and I just want everyone to get away from me. Hey, how many of you have done that? How many of you have got kids? Have you ever said this? If you haven't, you're not a good parent. Get away from me. I've said that to my children. Get away from me. Go to your room and do something. You've got 750 gadgets in there. Anyway, sorry. Get away with me. The lesson here is to push pause. This is why God gives us the Sabbath, to rest. Push pause. Stop. Make everything in your life stop. But let's not make the mistake of merely getting away, but getting away with Him. The way we grow this relationship is we don't just try to get away, but we get away with Him. Because running from life never gives you any comfort. Being in denial never resolves anything. Acting like it's not there or just ignoring life does not make it go away. But when you pursue the purpose to praise and to pray, it changes things. Retreat into that closet of prayer and watch as God changes your perspective and even changes your situation. It's in getting away with Him that things change. Not just getting away, but getting away. So he says, come to me. And then he says, get away with me. And then he says, walk and work with me. It's this relationship of walking and working with Jesus that changes everything in our life and that causes this relationship to move forward, to move into progress. The good life is attained through this relationship. It means to go in the same direction of God. It means to do what He would do. It means the good life is about taking the right direction and working out the purpose of the Father. In other words, here's what it means. It means to stop going and doing your thing and asking God to bless it. It means go to God and ask Him, what direction do you want my life to go? What direction do you want my life to take? Where do you want me to go? How do you want me to affect life? What do you want me to do? And then knowing if you do what God leads you to do, it will be blessed. You won't have to pray for Him to bless it. Come on, somebody. That's how you grow in your relationship with God. Put Him first. Come on, somebody. Everybody say it with me. Put Him first. Come on, say it again. Put Him first. Then he goes on to say, watch me. In other words, he's saying have a teachable spirit. Have a teachable spirit. There's a right way to do things and there's a wrong way to do things. Your burden will be easy and your burden will be light if you do it His way. Marriage His way. Finances His way. Friendships His way. Direction and purpose His way. Come on. You do that and your burden all of a sudden becomes light because He said, I won't put something heavy or ill-fitting on you. I know what you're made for. I know what you're capable of. That's the yoke that I'll put on you. And you'll walk with me and it will be light. Not because you're so awesome, but because I'm so awesome, God says. Because I'm standing in the other side of the yoke. And you're not carrying the weight by yourself. You're not carrying the heaviness by yourself. Come on, somebody. Have a teachable spirit. Take those complex. Let God take those complex and complicated things in your life and make it simple. You know how you make your life simple? We can get schedules out. We can get priorities out. We can get all. But you know how you make your life simple? Start with God. The Bible says the beginning of wisdom is the reverence of God. Listen to me. Start with God. Everything, in every area of your life, start with God. And your life will become incredibly simple. Because decisions for most of the things you're going to do after that will already be made. Amen. Are y'all hearing me today? And the last thing he said is keep company with me. In other words, develop and maintain a contentment relationship a continual relationship. Hang out with Jesus. Be in church every time the doors are open. Have a daily prayer time where you seek the face of God and study His Word. If you're keeping company with God, you'll have very little time to keep company with the negatives in life. And when you do keep company with people who are not people who are going to help you or edify you, it'll be for the purpose of reaching them, for touching them, for changing their life. Amen? And so I'm going to close with this. What is the most difficult obstacle that we face when coming to this relationship with God? What is it? What is the thing that stands in our way from having this effective, connected relationship with God? What is it? Is it sin? Is it pressure? Is it problems? Is it independence? What is it? What is it that is standing in our way from being everything we need to be in that connected, contented, good life with God? He said, I came to give you life and life more abundant. What stands in the way? Let me tell you what stands in the way. Relationship. What? Yes, what stands in the way is relationship. If we allow other relationships to have an inappropriate place in our life, it will destroy the good life. If we put other relationships in a preeminent place above our relationship with Christ, it will destroy the good life. If you want all of your other relationships to be effective and to be impacting and to be good and to be whole and to be blessed, then the thing to do is put that relationship with God at the center of your life, at the preeminent place of your life, on the throne of your life. And then all those other relationships will be blessed. All of those other relationships will be taken care of. All those other relationships will be the best they can be. Why? Because God's first. God's first. Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, Jesus said something very controversial. And no one teaches or preaches on this because no one wants to deal with it. But let me just tell you what he said. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 34 through 39, the Message Bible reads this way. Don't think I've come to make life cozy. I've come to cut. I've come to make a sharp knife cut between son and father, between daughter and mother, between bride and mother-in-law. Cut through these cozy domestic arrangements and free you for God. Listen, well-meaning family members can be your worst enemy. If you prefer father or mother over me, you don't deserve me. If you prefer son and daughter over me, you don't deserve me. Now listen, in this world, I think we've made a mistake. Good Christian people, we've made a mistake. Because we see families falling apart everywhere. We see marriages falling apart everywhere. We see kids going awry and astray everywhere. And our answer is to put our family at the center. To make our kids the most important thing ever in our lives ever and do everything they want to do and let them do. To make them the God of our life. To make family the preeminent relationship in our life. And let me just tell you, if you want your family to be right, if you want your children to be right, if you want your purpose to be right, if you want your destiny to be right, that's a wrong move. Because no one else should be sitting in the preeminent place of your life. The right move then is to put Jesus in the preeminent place. And He will then lead all of those other relationships to be fulfilling and satisfying and happy and moving forward and growing and developing. Because out of that relationship you have with Him is the filter through which you'll see your relationship you have with them. Is Jesus trying to say, I want you to hate your family? No, He's using very extreme language to say that your love for me, in the New King James Bible, it literally says, I've come to make you hate your family. Well, He didn't mean hate. What He was saying was He was using extreme language to say, your love for me in comparison to your love for your family, you would consider that hate. In other words, He's saying, you should love me so much that no one else can influence you away from me. Not mom and dad, not spouse, not kids, nobody. No friendships can influence you away from me. No one else can be the center, only me. I can be the center. And out of that place, I'll change your whole entire life for the positive. Talking about living the good life. You'll live the good life. Your relationships will reap the most harvest. Your friendships, your family. It will be so good. It will be so overcoming. It will be so powerful. And there'll be no need for worry or anxiety or stress because God's got this. Why? Because you're in the center. You're in the pocket. You're in the middle of His will. And there's no devil in hell that can mess with you when you're in the palm of the hand of God and He's leading and guiding and direct your life. Circumstances may come. Weapons may be formed. Issues may happen. But you're going to stand firm. Why? Because God has got His hand on your life. Why? Because He's first. His relationship with you is so strong and could be so great if we just walk that out continually. Come to me. Get away with me. Watch me. Work with me. I'll make it light. I'll make it free. I'll make it whole. I'll make it complete. You'll accomplish purpose. You'll live for destiny. Your family will be great. Everything's going to be okay. I'll protect and provide and love and care and watch over because that's who I am and that's what I do. But the question is this relationship, it's the second part of the good life. And the question is, where is your relationship with Him? Where is it? I'm not just talking about salvation. I'm talking about every one of us here today that are saved and Christian and following Christ. Where is our relationship with Christ really? Where does He sit in the area of priority when it comes to all other relationships? Listen, you won't settle for anything else if you get this right. You won't, because it'll change your life for good. Amen. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? I'm not telling you to go home and hate your family. Come on. I'm not telling you to go home and tell your wife, hey, Pastor David said, don't get in my way, girl. You know what I'm saying? I mean, don't do that. I didn't say that. What I'm saying is Jesus used very extreme language to say, look, I know what's best for you. And if you'll just do what I say, if you just follow me, if you just be in deep relationship with me, I'll take care of the rest. Doesn't He say that in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33? Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. All these things will be added. Let's pray. Father,